Recording. I'm trying to think if there are like any Egyptian themed VTubers.
Bah.
I'm sure there are. Or mythology theme just in general. Seems like
it feels like with the like Percy Jackson's about to come back, maybe that will like do something.
That's got like an oddly dedicated community.
People love Percy Jackson.
Yeah.
I miss the boat. I'm not judging anyone. I'm a Harry Potter kid, you know, and like fucking that's got a whole bunch of baggage. But like I just completely missed the boat on it. So when people were like crying out like they fucked up the books, like I'm sure they did because those were bad movies. Apologies to Alexandra Daddario and Logan Lerman.
Mm-hmm.
But like I didn't know. I had no context. I was just like, I forgot about these.
Yeah.
And then like 10 years later, people are telling me like, oh, I loved reading those as a kid growing up. And I was like, well, I knew you as a kid growing up. I didn't know that. So where the fuck did all these people come from?
Yeah, but you don't talk about books with your friends, really.
Like, not when you're young, when you're I guess.
Yeah. Like, you all go off and read on your own. And then you're like, I can't let them know I was reading Captain Underpants.
But, and now I'm like, no, the Captain Underpants movie was really good.
Yeah, and like, those books are actually deeply subversive. Mm-hmm. Should be pushed on children more.
Yeah. Oh, is Captain Underpants a failed blockbuster?
Did it bomb? Because I saw that shit in theaters, which is like
I did too. Yeah. That was one of the movies I got to watch like way early. I think.
Nope. It was only a $38 million budget. It made $125 million.
Okay, so what the fuck? How come it didn't get a sequel?
I think it got an animated series.
Oh, you fucking...
Yeah, that was that weird... That's that weird transitional area for DreamWorks, where, like...
Oh.
DreamWorks is, like, they're starting to produce a bunch of, like, really cheap animated films, and then, like, you know... Also, like, I think I said my biggest problem with that movie, though, is mm-hmm. I'm not a giant fan of Ed Helms. As Mr. Krupp. He's great at Captain Underpants, but he mm-hmm. wasn't good as Mr. Krupp, which is an important detail.
Okay. Also, it's not a failed blockbuster, but that's what we're here to talk about today with Alex Proyas' 2016 Gods of Egypt. Hello, I'm
all you Proyas heads, rise up.
Hey, there are Proyas heads out there. Yeah, that's my co-host, Matt Garingo.
One of them was Roger Ebert.
Oh, yeah, I forgot.
Roger Ebert
yeah.
loved Dark City. To the point that he has a commentary track on the, like, Blu-ray.
That's so... I haven't listened to that yet. I should have.
I haven't either. You know what? Like, I listened to his... Because he also did a commentary for Citizen Kane. So I've heard that one.
Yeah. Okay, I gotta check that out.
Yeah, I don't know if it's on the recent Criterion. I don't know what the rights are in terms of... commentary tracks and stuff like
that. I talked to you about this from the last episode of Miami Vice, where like there are people like who will upload like audio commentaries now because some of the like copies are harder to find, rights go up in the air, whatever, people getting stingy with shit. So yeah, there's ways to find it out there now. You just gotta like really dig deep or just ask around on Twitter.
Yeah,
frankly,
people give you the deets.
There's an account that just like They'll tweet out scenes from movies with the commentary tracks over them, mm-hmm. and then in like the reply, they'll link to like a mega link for the commentaries.
There you go.
And you know, it's a way of keeping that aspect of the art form alive, which I think is like really cool.
I think though now, like it seems like a lot of digital copies that go up are starting to come with special features, like especially on Apple. So maybe that'll be the future. Mm-hmm. Eventually you'll be able to buy a copy of Evil Dead that comes with every single special feature ever made.
Yeah, instead of having to buy multiple ones.
Yeah.
So. Well, I'll say this. iTunes wasn't great at, like, categorizing that stuff before. So early, like, iTunes movie copies that I have, like Drive, for example, has no special features. But you buy it now, it's got some stuff.
All right.
It'll just take me straight to the movie.
All right, cool.
I don't understand why.
Did you ever watch movies or videos on your iPod?
Oh yeah, of course.
Like that's how I watched all of Tim and Eric when it first aired. I did
that's amazing.
First two seasons, and it was just me and my friend Chris Yu, shout out to Chris Yu, and we would share the headphones and we would just sit on like the bleachers at the school and we would just watch Tim and Eric on my phone. Oh, those were the days.
I did a lot of Lost rewatches on there. I bought episodes of Lost. Not all of them, but I bought a handful of them. Because they were the hypest shit ever, and they still are.
Wasn't Lost, though, like, Lost, before, like, streaming, you could just watch Lost on your computer.
You could watch it on ABC. ABC had a terrific website. They were kind of ahead of the curve with the ABC television.
Yeah.
Like, just putting their shows up there for people to catch up on, you know? And even though Lost viewers, like, on the regular network readings, whatever, like, it was still huge online.
I think they understood that, like, to keep this thing alive, you have to make easy access to all the episodes, like, in a pre-streaming era, because, like, it's a hard show to be, like, season 4 starts this week, jump on, like, you can't really do that, you know?
Yeah.
Because that was the thing, like, they talk about Breaking Bad was kind of saved by Netflix. Like, Breaking Bad did not have good ratings for, like, the first 4 seasons, which is crazy.
Yeah, and then fucking Netflix blew it up, and everyone was like, wait, the show fucking rocks. Yeah.
And, like, literally,
where is it on?
They already signed all the deals to make season 5 the last season, and that's when the ratings, like, went through the roof. Like, that's partly why Better Call Saul exists, because they tapped into Breaking Bad, like, a little too late in terms of popularity, you know?
Yeah, and, you know, we're recording the day after the
finale.
I
have not seen it yet.
I have not seen it either. So, I'm still making my way through it on Netflix, so eventually I'm going to have to get that final season.
Hot take, like, good show.
AMC+. It's fucking terrific.
I know.
It is so impressive.
How far into it are you?
I'm right at the end of season 1. Okay. So I'm not that far, but it's so good.
Its last season is interesting in contrast to how Breaking Bad played out.
Okay.
Where Breaking Bad kind of had, like, that, like, sort of intensity to it, which is kind of the whole Better Call Saul thing. Like, Breaking Bad had, like, a sort of, like, immediate intensity, whereas Better Call Saul is, like, just watching, like, a slow collapse, and it's just great. It's great shit. So.
Yeah. I'm glad Vince Gilligan is so, like, he has such an understanding of writing.
Although he is no longer the head writer on the show.
Oh, then I apologize, but at least from what I've seen from the get-go, right, like, it was inherently a different direction from Breaking Bad, because you can't repeat that.
Yeah.
And who is the new head writer?
It's the co-creator. I can't remember his name off the top of my head, but you've seen him listed everywhere. When you watch the show, when you watch that 15-second opening that my dad insists I hit the skip button for, which I don't know.
I saw someone do that for, like, an episode of The Office one time. And again, I'm not even someone that worships The Office or anything like that. And this is when it was on Netflix. And I was like, why? Like, why'd you do that? Like,
yeah. Peter, like, what, Gould.
It's like 20 seconds. Oh, Peter Gould. Yes. Clearly terrifically talented as well. Good job. Congrats,
like,
on the show, everyone.
The thing about both those shows that I appreciate is that they're just so open about, like, yeah, we didn't know what the ending was until we wrote it. Like, that they're just so kind of open about where, like, that they're just like, yeah, we kind of were making it up as we went along.
And we've talked about it before, but that's, like, totally in contrast to Game of Thrones, which was like, no, we know it now, so now we're going to, like, speedball it to the finale. And it's just like, no, don't ever do that. What the fuck was that?
Yeah, how did they just, that is, like, the biggest fumble in, like, modern history is just those last seasons of that show.
I was talking to some other friends about it recently, and I still think season 5 is, like, the worst. Like, it's just fucking miserable. Like, it's not just bad. Like,
yeah,
it's actively miserable.
It's all the tropes that the show is, like, known for and, like, used, like, poorly, you know? It's just, like, it's, and now, like, I'm really worried about fucking House of the Dragon, because they talked about how, like how they're gonna try and handle sexual violence better in it. And it's, like, the way it was, like, that statement came out, it's like, you still don't understand what you're really doing and what you're playing with here. And it's, yeah, like, once you get to season 5 of Game of Thrones, it's just, like, awful. Especially that shit. They just don't, they're not thinking about the sexual politics of it at all.
Yeah. And, I mean, Jaime Lannister, this is my pivot into Gods of Egypt. Jaime Lannister became, like, kind of one of my favorite characters by season 3 and 4, like, the way they peel back, like, the layers of, like, this really fucked up guy, and then, like, you know, they kind of, like, lose that thread, and then they get it back, and then they lose it again, and then, like, they lose everything. But Nicolaj Coster-Waldau, I was like, this is like a really good actor.
What he is the a fuck? Good like, actor, honestly.
What happened outside of Game of Thrones? Because, like, he's also in Headhunters, which I like. Mm-hmm. And then he's in a movie called Clown Forever.
Well.
It's a Danish. Okay, it's a Danish comedy, so that's probably Danish humor. I don't know, you guys.
He's in Oblivion. I remember him in Oblivion.
Oh my god, I totally fucking forgot.
No one remembers the movie Oblivion.
I remember the pretty images.
You remember seeing it, you remember enjoying it, but you don't really remember.
Yeah, I like Joseph Kaczynski. I am not crazy about Oblivion.
Do you remember that Morgan Freeman is in Oblivion?
I do remember that.
That was something where like I have to kind of remind myself every now and then that Morgan Freeman was in that movie.
Yeah. Oh, Nicolas Coster-Waldau was also in Brian De Palma's most recent film, Domino.
Domino. God, he's not picking the right movies.
That one he got, like, fucked on, though. That was a whole thing.
That's a whole thing, but still, it's... You know, he seems to be making a pivot of being like, I'm going to work with interesting directors. And it's just not really paying off.
Yeah.
But maybe he's just got, like, those... You get so much fucking money if you run a show like Game of Thrones for that long.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, maybe so that's it.
Hopefully that... Oh, it's always sad when you see, like, they're listed, and it's like Jamie Lannister on Game of Thrones and an episode of Saturday Night Live.
That was 2015, so that was like, oh, that was season 5, I guess, then, right?
Yeah, this is like the kind of the moment where like Game of Thrones is like starting to crack,
like, mm-hmm. It's never getting more popular, and I'm like, wait, no, everyone, there's something wrong here.
Yeah.
Wait.
I'm kind of amazed anyone even stuck with it through season 5. Like, I guess it was the Jon Snow thing. It does end on the Jon Snow thing.
Yeah, the last two episodes, because they do Hardhome, that fucking, like, the most metal shit ever. It's like a really good episode. I think it's the first one my boy Miguel Sapochnik directed. Mm-hmm. And it's like all the direction is making up for like some adequate, not the worst writing of the season. And then it's just like, oh no, it does the White Walker set piece for like 20 minutes. And it's just like the most metal shit ever. And it's like, it's got this perfect culmination. The Lich King? What's the dude's
the
name?
The Knights.
Yeah. The Lich King.
Which is hysterical that like, we got the Night's King on the show. The Night's King has yet to appear in the books, which is
wild. Like in the world of the show, at least that made sense for like Jon's arc, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, Jon saves as many people as he can, and then he just stares back at the dude, and then the Night's King raises the Army of the Dead. It's this perfect like culmination point of like, okay, this is the conflict heading into the final show. Mm-hmm. Nothing else really matters. We got to finish that as soon as possible. This is like, it's like me, you, us, them.
Yeah.
It's like so fucking awesome. Miguel Sapochnik should direct a movie.
Did he also do Battle of the Bastards?
Yes.
Yeah, because that's the other one. So I think that's the thing that kind of keeps it afloat is that ending and then the Battle of the Bastards are like the two things that kind of get people to be like, eh, it might work out, you know?
Mm-hmm. And then, he directed, I believe, the pilot of the House of the Dragon. So okay. They fucking got me.
That the house, I don't know, man. I just don't know.
I don't even know when it comes out. I was so impressed with his work on Game of Thrones.
I'm sure it'll be directed fine. I just don't know if there's a story there.
Oh, probably not. I'm not talking about that, though.
It's, yeah. It's
have not, you ever just watched a pilot of something?
Of a show? Like,
yeah, and then they're like, okay, you're good.
I have, but it's usually times I've done that. I've like watched the pilot and been like, "That was bad," and then I don't watch the show. I remember watching I was so hyped for when they brought V back. Remember V?
I do remember V.
And like that pilot, the first episode of V was just terrible, and it was one of those like sinking, like, "Oh man, oh, I can't believe you fucked it up," and it was just awful. What network was that?
ABC.
ABC. All right. That was, that was the classic. We got to fill Lost. We got to find something to replace Lost.
All right. None of this has to do with Gods of Egypt. I'm going to keep it in, though, because this is kind of how my mind works when I'm watching Gods of Egypt.
This is every episode of the show, though, as we talk like this.
Yeah, but like this one, it feels like more painfully obvious that we didn't like this movie.
I guess. I didn't hate it, though.
No. I don't hate it either.
I was, like, just bored. It's such a...
I have positives.
I do, too. I have exactly... Let me look at my notes. I have exactly 5 positives. So,
oh, okay.
But, yeah. Not great. Mostly boring and forgettable is the thing. And shocking that this movie even got greenlit.
It is. I will say that I'll get some positives out of the way first, because I don't know if they're like hot takes or whatever, but like I really like how sincere it is.
Yeah, there's a heart like, to it.
It bums me out that it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Sorry, you were gonna say something.
No, I'm just agreeing with you.
Okay, like yeah, it's got like it's like a little nice little heartwarming story about like a god learning to be humble, which I love in Thor, obviously. So maybe I like that here too, and like how it's about like sharing the power he has to like that was within him all along with like everyone else. Like it can't just be the gods ruling over everything. So by the end of the film, spoilers, he gives it to the people who helped him become his best self. I was like, okay, this is like a nice arc. And the Egyptian gods look like Transformers, which I'm like, I'm sure people were like fucking rioting over or just didn't care. But I was like, I don't know. It looks cool. I think it's cool that blood can be gold for gods.
The gold blood is cool. Yeah. I like the really, here's the thing. The best special effects in this movie are like the really simple ones.
Yes.
And it's like the fact that all the Egyptian gods are like fucking like gigantic compared to people. Like, there's so much thought, and they exist in the same, like, it's pretty seamless when you watch it, that they're on the same scene, but then when, like, the action takes over, you're just, like, immediately tired, and you're like, what am I watching?
And I think the height difference stuff works. Mm-hmm. When they're, like, moving around a lot, not just in action, but, like, when they're just kind of wandering, like, the more fantastical landscapes, it sometimes looks really bad. Yep.
Yeah, that looks pretty bad. Well, I mean, most of the landscapes in general just look bad.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's just, I don't know. It's something that we've never been able to crack where it's just like these digital movies just aren't that interesting. And it's like only James Cameron can like get it right. And James Cameron and the Wachowskis. Mm-hmm. Like, and I don't even know why. I couldn't tell you why it works there and not here. Other than the fact that fucking Alex Proyas couldn't stop his camera from moving. And the editing in this is pretty bad. There's some pretty bad moment-to-moment editing in this was, like, jarring in its awfulness.
Yeah, what is Alex Proyas' deal?
I don't know, because he has directed a few, like, only a handful of movies. He did The Crow, which is, like, infamous. He did Dark City, which is kind of the movie that comes out before The Matrix and bombs, and then The Matrix comes out a year later and is like the hit. Like, so like Dark City was just like a little too early, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like this missing link between The Matrix and Blade Runner in a way.
Yeah.
He does Garage Days, which I've never seen. Have you seen that?
I've not seen Garage Days. I have no idea what that is, actually.
He does iRobot, which is a bad movie.
No, iRobot is fun.
iRobot is a bad movie mainly because it's written by Akiva Goldsman, and at some point you can tell that it just was like, we gotta just make this fit the Will Smith thing. And the Will Smith thing is whatever Will Smith is interested in at any given moment. And Will Smith, for whatever reason, wants to be known as like a hardened badass who like lacks humanity, even though his best characters tend to be the ones with the most humanity.
Yeah, that is weird. I don't really get that from that movie. At least not that much, because, like, he likes humanity okay.
He hates his boss. He talks down Dr. Susan Calvin all the time. He doesn't like Sonny, and, like, Sonny has to warm up to him. And he doesn't like anyone, really. The only guy he seems to like is James Cromwell, and he dies before the movie starts.
Oh, yeah.
And,
well, see, that's, like, his last connection to, like, his own humanity. He has to, like, regain it through, like, the journey of that film.
Yeah.
Which is maybe, like, Alex Proyas' thing. That's what he's interested
maybe.
In.
Maybe. Yeah, that seems to be a recurring thing. Yeah. But
he's got big ideas.
The movie's just not very good.
I get a kick out of iRobot. I'll go to bat for iRobot.
It ends with like a dumb fight on top of a building that is uninteresting. Also, have you ever read iRobot?
I have. Yeah. I read it after I saw the movie and liked it, and I was like, what the fuck happened?
Also, there's the infamous like Harlan Ellison screenplay for an iRobot movie that was going to be made by Irvin Kershner back in the 80s that like never got made. And it's one of those where like, it was one of those people were trying to forever, and then someone just like, just turn iRobot into a Will Smith action movie. I do like the one scene when his lieutenant confuses Frankenstein and the Wolfman when they're at the bar. Do you remember that scene?
No, I don't.
There's that scene in the bar where like they're talking about robots because that's all people do in this movie. And is like, no, this is just like the Wolfman. And he's like, what do you mean? He's like, man creates monster, monster kills man, just like the Wolfman. And then he's like, no, it's Frankenstein. He's like, doesn't matter. Like, that's like the one really good scene in the movie. And Shia LaBeouf was in it. Remember that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, boy.
In that moment where I'm like, I'm rooting for Shia LaBeouf.
Yeah.
And then I wasn't. And then I wasn't for a few years. And then it kind of came back. And I'm like, oh, wait, I'm back. I'm back to rooting for Shia LaBeouf. And then, no, not anymore.
Yeah. That was a bummer. I will say my favorite part of iRobot, it's in all the trailers, I think, but it's when he has like a really bad day and then he gets onto the freeway and then the two fucking big robot trucks like kind of sandbox him in on the tunnel. And then he's just like, oh, there's no way my luck is that bad. And then it opens up and all the robots start trying to kill him. That's fun.
Yeah, sure. If you like,
it's a good movie.
Like a bunch of digital guys jumping around.
Yeah, it looks cool. They're cool designs.
What year did that movie take place in?
2035.
Okay, so we still have time.
We have time to stop the robot uprising.
Yeah, the three lost.
Although, the twist in that film is... Wait, what? No, no. It was the robot.
Yeah, it was. It was the other. It was just a different one.
It was just a different robot.
And the whole thing was like, see, I had to make a robot that was like free from its like restraints in order to stop the actual robots. Like, they're just following their programming. You know, it was the free robot that actually saved the day.
Mm-hmm.
That is the one good thing when he takes the hologram to the graveyard, to like the junkyard, remember?
Yeah,
where it's
yeah.
Like he figures out that like, oh, I'm supposed to ask those. Like, that's a pretty neat idea. But the movie's not the best.
No, it's good. It's better than Gods of Egypt.
Sure.
I will say, I think iRobot's like action's like really solid.
Yeah, there's some.
And
good...
in Gods of Egypt, I actually kind of like some of the set piece ideas. But it feels so cobbled together, and I don't know why.
I think it's just the like digital filmmaking. Everyone's like, every movie's got to look like Avatar now. And it just never, like, no one could do it. Like, no.
Maybe this is 7 years after
Avatar. I know, but it does feel like it's part of that wave, though. Like, what's so weird about Gods of Egypt is that it feels like it's part of two waves, right? Mm-hmm. It feels like, A, it's part of post-300, we still think Gerard Butler is going to make us money.
Oh.
And it also seems post-Avatar, and by post-Avatar, what I really mean is post the Clash of the Titans remake. Which came out, like, the year after, which was the Sam Worthington, like, other Sam Worthington vehicle, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which was, like, it's in 3D, even though it looked terrible. And it made, like, $400 million. And that's, like, 6 years before. And it just, they're just way, like, you would tell it was in the pipeline, and that's the reason this movie got as far as it did. And then it might have just been one of those moments where someone was like, we have spent too much fucking money developing this Gods of Egypt movie. Like, we just have to make it now. Mm-hmm. And then it was just too late. Like, it just wasn't gonna work. Like,
This movie, I just found out what the influences were on it, according to Alex Proyas. Mm-hmm. Do you know this?
I think I saw that. He like listed like Guns of the Navarone, like Lawrence of Arabia, which, I mean, any movie in the fucking desert is influenced by Lawrence of Arabia.
Yeah, whether people recognize it or not.
To the
like,
point,
no, it
like,
just is.
To the point, like, just stop. Like,
yeah.
Like, let it be. Like, it's like that thing of, like, don't read The Hero with a Thousand Faces. Just let, like, all those beats develop, like, naturally.
Mm-hmm.
Like, don't try to hit him. Just don't watch Lawrence of Arabia. You'll hit those beats. The Man Who Would Be King, Raiders of the Lost Ark, because why not? And Sergio Leone. And
I see Raiders more than any of the other ones.
I definitely see Lawrence of Arabia. I don't see Guns of the Navarone at all, frankly.
Yeah.
I don't know what he's talking about there.
I don't know.
I mean, it is like an action film, like it's one of the proto action movies, but no, it's there's none of that really here. And I mean the man who would be king is like kind of obvious. I don't see Sergio Leone that much either. If it was influenced by him, people would talk a lot fucking less, which might help the movie. Yeah. Did you notice the guys who wrote it, though?
No.
It's two guys, Matt Sazma, I'm going to pronounce these wrong, and Burke Sharpless.
Okay, that makes so much sense.
And they have written Dracula Untold, The Last Witch Hunter, Gods of Egypt, Power Rangers, Morbius, and apparently they still went through with shooting Madam Web, which they started filming in July.
So there are some leaks about what that movie's about.
Oh, is it a good leak?
You're going to be so mad.
Oh, what is it?
Or maybe you just won't care anymore.
What is it about? I want to know.
This is out there. I feel comfortable saying it now. It's Terminator.
What?
Instead of going back in time to kill Sarah Connor to give birth to John, who's giving birth to John Connor, it's about going to kill Aunt May to stop her from giving birth to Peter Parker.
Aunt May doesn't give birth to Peter Parker.
Or what the fuck? the other one, the other May. Sorry, I apologize. The other May.
You mean...
His mom.
Yeah, okay.
His mom.
So Madame Web is coming back in time from a spider world.
I don't know the character details. Is probably why I said Aunt May instead of his mom.
But I'm guessing, what I'm guessing is she's coming from like a spider world where like everything's taken over and like they gotta stop Spider-Man for some reason. I bet you we'll see the spider world and it'll look really cool and then like none of the movie will take place there.
S.J. Clarkson's directing it.
I'm sure it'll be great.
She is a good director who can't fucking get a movie off the ground.
Yeah.
Of course, this is the one she gets off the ground.
That seems to be how it goes. Who was the woman that was lined up to do Wonder Woman initially? It was someone connected to Breaking Bad.
Oh, Michelle McLaren.
Yeah. Has she made anything yet?
No. She's fucking good.
Yeah, she is. She was supposed to be doing a Jim Jones movie with Vince Gilligan. And it was either going to be a movie or a miniseries. Like, that was the thing she was kind of left for. But I guess, did you hear about, like how she was, like, going to do Wonder Woman and, like, what got her, like, kicked off of it?
I forget now.
She was apparently the only one that remembered that Wonder Woman has the ability to talk to animals. So, like, Wonder Woman was going to have, like, a tiger that followed her around.
Oh, okay, and they were like, we can't do that.
The studio was like, that sounds dumb. And then Macaringo was like, that sounds like the best movie ever.
Yeah.
And they were like, well, clearly we don't want that audience, so...
Well, Patty Jenkins worked out for them.
Oh, yeah, it worked out great.
The first time.
Yeah. Worked out for, like, until the last 10 minutes of that movie.
I like the whole movie.
That movie's way better than it really has any right to be. Like,
yeah, that movie shouldn't work, really.
It really shouldn't. And, like, Wonder Woman 84... I feel like everyone's hung up on the wrong shit with Wonder Woman 84, though. Like... It's like the people like poking, like, why does it look so goofy? I'm like, I love that it looks goofy.
Like that's intentional.
Yeah, it's just.
And I like the movie, but like, you know, I can't admit that in public. I'll just admit it on the podcast.
You like Wonder Woman 84?
Yeah, I thought it was okay.
Why?
I don't have time to get into that.
Cheetah doesn't even show up to the last 5 minutes, and she doesn't look like a cheetah.
They dropped the ball so hard, not just with like adapting the character, but like that arc, like is like really weird. And, like, she's coming into her own like Diana is, but she's doing it wrong because I guess she beats up, like, a man harassing a woman. Like, I guess that's crossing the line. Like, it's framed as crossing the line in the movie.
Who wrote
that? It's
like,
no, that's pretty. That's a good one. Do that.
All right, it was Patty Jenkins and Jeff Johns and another guy. I lay all the blame at the feet of Jeff Johns.
I was going to say, too, yeah. Not to be, like, one of, like, the Snyder cultists or anything like that, but, yeah, that makes a lot of
sense.
And, like,
Jeff Johns isn't even, like, awful, but like he's got terrible instincts and he always thinks he has to reinvent the wheel with like every character, and like when he does it like doesn't work, so just
sometimes you got to keep shit simple. And I'll say, like, the best parts of Gods of Egypt that I like, you know, keeps it simple. It's like, what is fucking Set want. Oh, he wants to rule everything.
He wants to rule everything. He wants to defeat death. And it's like, sure, right on, man. Like, that's.
I will say, I think Gerard Butler is excellent.
But here's the thing. Is Gerard Butler, like, bad? Like, did we just, like, convince ourselves he was bad? Like.
No, he fucking rocks. He's Dude's Rock.
Yeah, he's like, the personification of Dude's Rock.
Yeah.
And I think it was the 300 thing. When 300 came out, everyone was like, this is the coolest movie ever. And then, like, 2 years later, people were like, actually, that movie sucks. And then now it's, like, in a weird, like, limbo state. And then he just picked, like, a bunch of weird, not great movies. Also, he was the Phantom of the Opera and was not good as the Phantom. Did you ever see that?
Oh, my God, I forgot.
Where I have not seen that since, like, Point of No Return. Like,
I haven't seen that since, like, fucking HBO, like, the year after it came out. Mm-hmm. So I cannot vouch for it, but I forgot he was the Phantom.
He's not good in it. Why he was picked, I don't know.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
But Gerard Butler's definitely had a renaissance, especially with, like, the action film Twitter.
Oh, man, he also did, like, a bunch of shit that no one remembers, like Nim's Island.
Yeah, Nim's Island, P.S. I Love You.
The Ugly Truth.
Rock and Rolla, which rocks.
Rock and Rolla, which they've never made the sequel that they promised.
I know.
It's probably too late.
Guy Ritchie, fuck.
It has one of my favorite tropes in movies, which are the unkillable Russians that you just, like, you yes. do anything you can to them and they just won't go down, which is, yeah. like, always funny.
He did a movie called Machine Gun Preacher, which should be a masterpiece just from the title alone, and it's, like, not.
Oh, it was the Leprechaun in movie 43.
Oh, my God.
We keep going back to that.
It's tied into everything. It's kind of like, you know, it's like a virus.
Here's something wild. Did you ever see 300 Rise of an Empire?
I did.
Oh, my God. You might be the only one.
No, there are people out there. There are people that like it more than the first.
If I don't like the first, I doubt I'm going to like 300 Rise of an Empire.
I don't think you would either. I do not. I want to make that clear.
Well, Eva Green's in it, and, like, I'd kind of watch her in anything.
Yeah, no, she's great in it.
I'd watch Eva Green in a video of her killing my whole family. And then
pointing at the camera
and being like, you're next, motherfucker.
Yeah, and I'd be like, I hope so.
And I'm like, hey, all right. She's great. She's great and shit.
And, of course, Gerard Butler is in action film Twitter favorites, Geostorm.
You know what?
And
I
masterpiece,
did not,
Den of Themes.
I did not like Geostorm.
Ah.
I'm sorry. Like, I know people were into it.
I like Geostorm.
I thought Geostorm kind of sucked.
Den of Thieves
is, like, Dumb Guy Thief. Dumb Guy Heat.
Oh, yeah.
It's really good.
It's fucking rocks.
But the one that I think more people should be talking about, frankly, is Cop Shop, the Joe Carnahan film.
Yes, he's great in Cop Shop.
Which is a wild little movie that has no right to exist. And it's just the last movie I will watch that has a cop protagonist. It's the last one, and I'm glad it got in under the wire because it's a good movie.
Yeah, it is a good movie.
But yeah, Gerard Butler's not bad. It's just I don't think he's an action star for, like, a genre of action films that just don't really exist in the mainstream anymore. You know?
I know. Yeah.
Like it's all that, like. It's like Olympus Has Fallen. Like, those are bad movies.
Those are all bad. I should be in the fucking bag for those, but they're so bad.
They're really bad.
Sorry, everyone.
But, what else did he do? He's also done, like, a bunch of weird drama films no one's heard of.
Wait, really? Like, what?
He did a movie called, like, A Family Man. Yeah, like, all titles that are, like, so, like, what is this one? Playing for Keeps. That's a romantic comedy. I don't remember that at all. He's also got, like, The Vanishing, which was the other Lighthouse movie.
Oh.
But I think it's more just, like, a straightforward, like, horror film as opposed to The Lighthouse.
Oh, my God, I totally fucking forgot. He was in the legendary Reign of Fire.
Yes, which is a good movie.
Reign of Fire is worth checking out.
It's a good, like, rental, like, afternoon, like, got nothing better to fucking do on a Sunday.
Yeah.
Put Reign of Fire on.
Mm-hmm.
it should be better on it. It's sad. Like, I wish it was a better movie, but for what it is, it's solid.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's Rob Bowman went on to do, like, Elektra. Mm-hmm. You know?
I have never seen Elektra.
Not good.
Yeah, no one seems to be reclaiming that one.
No. But it still comes from a time where there was, like, inherent, like, stylization and, like, lighting techniques. Yeah, there was craft required. So even, like, some dog shit, you're like, you know, at least it looks okay.
Oh, my God. He was in Lara Croft Tomb Raider, The Cradle of Life. Remember that?
Oh my God! Isn't that fucking Jan de Bont's like last movie?
Yes, which is wild. Fuck, to think about. Man. Did he do the first one? No, he didn't. Did wow, one. He only did the second Tomb Raider.
Yeah.
Kind of wild that Angelina Jolie like looked exactly like Lara Croft.
Yeah.
They did the other. Did you ever see the other Tomb Raider?
Oh, with Alicia Vikander.
Yeah.
I did. I didn't care for it either, but I like her.
Why can't they get that right? Like, Tomb Raider, it's just like, it's just Indiana Jones but with a lady. Like,
I know. Well, they can't get Indiana Jones ripoff right either. You see Uncharted?
I guess. You know what? I haven't seen Uncharted either.
It's just fucking boring. And you know what? This is what fucking kills me. This fucking guy who makes that movie, makes these other movies, they all have, like, the occasional interesting idea for, like, an action set piece or something. And I'm like, yeah, you describe it to me. I'm like, that sounds fucking awesome. And then I watch it, and I'm like, what were you doing, dude? Mm-hmm. What the fuck? Like, everything is barely, like, cobbled together coverage of a sequence, you know? Like, there's no motivated camera movements or placements or keeping a camera in, like, a single location so you can, like, capture a big, like, swathing movement. Like, say, falling out of a plane in midair. Or, like, helicopters raising a pirate ship, and then another helicopter raises a pirate ship, and those two helicopters with the two separate pirate ships battle midair.
Is that happening in Uncharted?
Yeah, doesn't that sound awesome?
Yeah, it does. And they fuck that up.
They fuck it up. God, so it's so boring.
Oh, that's awful.
I know that should be the shit. I should be like defending this movie till the day I die.
Yeah, Sky and Pirates. I can't. That's awful. Yeah, Ruben Fleischer. You know, I was invited to go enemies. See Zombieland Double Tap.
And
I'm like, I never turn up an opportunity to go to like a movie for free. And even that, I was like, I'm good. And so I didn't even go see Zombieland Double Tap.
I have not revisited the first Zombieland in a minute. Mm-hmm. Wait, did I? I don't even remember.
That was one where I saw it in theaters and like had a great time. I got it on DVD, watched it once, and I was like, oh, this isn't as good as I remembered it. And, like, I haven't revisited it since.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, like, it's such a fond, like, memory of a movie for me. I'm kind of cool to just leave it there and have that, you know?
Yeah.
I remember the big talking point was when filming ended, I remember the story. Woody Harrelson walked up to the director, hugged him, and said, I never wanted to do a sequel before today. Because they had such a great time making
it together.
Yeah,
but then there was that TV series no one remembers.
Yeah, because that's when Amazon's so fucked up. Because they were greenlighting pilots and letting viewers watch, like whatever viewers watched the most, they would greenlight that one. Whatever they liked, or they voted or something like that.
Wow.
And it's like, that's like not how you do it, man. Yeah. What the fuck?
Not according to the head of Warner Brothers Discovery.
Oh, yeah, that'll work out real well for him.
Yeah. I think their stock did go up, though. Because I think it went as low as it possibly could.
Oh, gotta get in on it.
Yeah. It's still going down. It is still overall down, but in the last... to go up in the last 5 days, it is up. But it is very rocky. It's like Uber stock. Where, like, Uber's constantly going up and down, up and down. Yeah, today it has risen a few cents. It's about 20 cents today. But hey, nowhere to go but up, right, Diego? I hope those stories we're hearing are true about what's going on there. Like, they're probably not. Too. But although, like, the other stuff that's been coming out, like, at all these studios sounds so dumb that it's like, this seems like... It's like the fist fight after Howard the Duck came out. Like,
yeah.
Who knows how true that is, but it sounds like something that could happen.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But you know what? It's interesting you bring up What's-His-Fuck, who I don't care about, Fleischer. Because I also feel like the guys who wrote this, all their movies kind of have that same quality for me. Mm-hmm. Where it's like there's something on paper that sounds like it should be a better movie than it is. And then you watch the movie and it sucks.
Yeah, why can't they just make it like fun?
Maybe the maybe the scripts are better. Like, I'm not sure if script is the problem here. Like, they're kind of like generic, but the movies themselves are very bloated, and they're more bloated in that the action really sucks.
Mm-hmm.
But or that Power Rangers reboot.
You know what? I don't hate that
movie. I don't hate it either, but it's also like not good. You know, like it doesn't.
It's missing like crucial components of working.
It's one of those where it like comes so close, it just kind of makes you angrier a little bit. Like,
it frustrates me, but I got a soft spot for it for sure.
Someone got to do fucking Power Rangers right one of these days, right?
Yeah. Like, I think I've said my Power Rangers thing before, right?
You might have, but I probably forgot.
Okay, well, I that's another thing I completely missed the boat on, like Percy Jackson. I never saw any Power Rangers, not like a second, not a single frame outside of like internet memes once I got on there. And so I went into that movie basically blind. Everyone was like, oh, they're bringing What's-Her-Face from the animated series, or from the series. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I don't know who that is.
Who'd they bring from the series? Oh,
they're whitewashing her. And I was like, that sucks, but I don't know who
it is. Oh, Rita Repulsa, is that what we're talking about?
Yes, that one. Yeah, I can't even remember the name.
Elizabeth Banks was a great Rita Repulsa, though. Like, she was.
She's good. Having fun. Yeah. She's in a movie.
I had a bigger problem with Bill Hader as Alpha 5. I love really? Bill Hader. I love Bill Hader, but it just kind of was like, you could have gotten anyone to do Alpha 5.
Aww.
No offense. All right, sorry, give me your Power Rangers take.
Well, yeah, so I was going in blind, and I was like, I don't give a shit about Power Rangers. I'm gonna write my review for Audiences Everywhere. And I was like, I kind of liked it. And, like, the cast had such, like, natural chemistry.
Yeah, which is something that's so like, helps it a lot. Rare for these type of movies these days.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, but you gotta remember, that was Audiences Everywhere, Diego. You fucking liked everything back then. I remember your reviews.
Did I?
Yeah, you gave so many positive reviews to things. I used to drag them up to mock you, but we all had bad tastes in that time. We all thought the Marvel thing might actually work.
Oh, yeah. No, I did like all of those basically back then.
Yeah, so.
And now I'm like yelling at friends when they tell me they actually thought Shang-Chi was one of the best movies they've seen in years.
That's wild. That's the
one. I know. It just happened this weekend, and God bless them. But I was like, what are you talking about? Please don't say that in public.
Or just don't say it in front of me.
No. I want them to feel shame.
The big problem with the Power Rangers movie is no Bulk and Skull.
I don't know what that is.
Bulk and Skull were the two bullies that hung around and like made fun of the kids. But, like, you know, they'd always be like, I think those guys are the Power Rangers. And they'd be trying to prove it, but, like, they couldn't do it. And they had, like, the goofiest theme music. They had, like, a bumbling trombone music that played every time they walked on screen. And it's like, oh, here comes Bulk and Skull. And Bulk was the big one, and Skull was the skinny one. They were, like, a Laurel and Hardy. But the fun thing about them is that, like, they're the bullies. But, like, they have, like, the best arc on the show because they slowly start to reveal that they're actually good guys. Like, shit goes down, and, like, everyone's running away, and Bulk and Skull, like, run in there and, like, save children and shit. Like, it's the best.
Nice.
It's the best shit on that show. And they both stuck around for, like, ever. Like, the original cast had all left, and Bulk and Skull were still around. Like, and then they came back. They had a reunion some years ago. I'm not, like, a big Power Rangers head, but I watched enough of it to know, and I watched the clip on YouTube where, like, they finally reunite after all these years. And I was like, oh, man, Bulk and Skull are back. See, they should have been in it. I don't know why that didn't. Who thought that was a good idea to cut Bulk and Skull? That's the biggest mistake.
Maybe they would have brought him into the sequels.
Maybe. That's the big problem is now everything's like for the sequels, and you end up cutting all the good stuff.
Yeah, and like that's not the problem Gods of Egypt has, but it's definitely something like I've even talked to like other like writer pals about. They're like, yeah, I want this to be a franchise, so I'm saving this. I'm like, no, don't do that. Like, yeah. if it can be here, put it here.
If your story's good enough, you can actually, like, you know, make a franchise out of it later.
Yeah, like, you know, John Carpenter wasn't like, I want Halloween to be a 12-episode saga, so I'm going to save my ideas for 40 years. He was just like, I'm going to make some scary shit. And he did.
Florence Pugh confirms she and Zach Braff have split.
Oh, that's too bad.
That's too bad.
I'm not going to give my reaction to that on here right now.
That's too bad.
Your fireworks going off in the background.
Anyways, fireworks.
Yeah. Gods of Egypt. Another thing I really like about it is that I actually like the costumes a lot. Like costumes, I don't know how
although
respectable they are. I just think they're very impressive.
We got to get that out of the way before we kind of talk about anything else. Of just, like, the whitewashing accusations of this film, right?
Yeah. Well, they're less accusations and more like, hey, we got you,
yeah, motherfucker. It's more like there's white guys all over this fucking movie. Like, yeah. That's what it is. And
the gold blood is on their hands.
Exactly. You know? But it's one of those things where, like, when you watch it, though, the movie's, like, such a nothing. It's like, is this conversation even worth it, you know? Mm-hmm. But what's weird about it, like you said, I think you brought it up off mic, was that Exodus Gods and Kings is like 2 years before this, correct?
Yes, 2014.
Which also had the same problem of just like, I think fucking Sigourney Weaver is in there as an Egyptian. Like,
she is.
It's like so bad. And that movie got tons of shit. And that's where like Ridley Scott gave that quote that I always think of when people try to defend Ridley Scott.
Oh, no, please, it doesn't talk like this anymore.
Did you ever see that quote?
Yes, I know exactly which one you're talking about.
I'm not even going to repeat it because it's so awful, but...
If you just go to the Exodus Gods and Kings, like, Wikipedia page, I'm sure you'll find stuff. I'm sure you'll find the quote in, like, the divisive category or whatever it's called there. I know for a fact it's there because how could it not be? And it's right to be there, frankly.
Somehow, the gods... And King's Wikipedia page, the actual whitewashing controversy seems to have been kind of scrubbed a little bit from the Wikipedia page.
What?
Like, I'm not saying it's not there. It's just there's not an entire section dedicated to it.
Hmm.
Unlike Gods of Egypt, where on their Wikipedia page there is an entire section said racial and ethnic casting. And then you go, oh, well, I'm sure it's just like a few sentences, and it's like seven big paragraphs.
Yeah.
And I think part of it was Alex Proyas maybe being a little antagonistic with people over it. Alex Proyas needed to learn to shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
But didn't go well. It's just so weird when, like, this was huge when it happened, this discussion, and now no one even remembers the movie.
Yeah.
But, hey.
It's very strange, and it's like, you know, news just came out that James Franco was cast as Fidel Castro, which is like a whole can of worms because of him, not just being white, but because of him.
I forgot that happened.
Yeah. Him, but yeah, like
I'm sure look, it's wrong, but I'm sure his version of Castro would have been really subtle.
Well, like it's probably also not going to happen, and for some reason it's like it's not like an American Hollywood production, also, which is fucked up still. Mm-hmm. But I just think it's like, man, like. You think these problems might be more isolated, and they're just, like, not.
Well, it was also, this is the same year, this movie came out, is the same year as The Great Wall. Do you remember that?
I have that in my notes. Yeah. I was going to bring it up when we talk more about the atmosphere in 2016.
Yeah, it was like, that was like another weird moment where it was like, you put a white guy as the hero of a movie called The Great Wall, and that movie was, like, produced in China, right? Like,
yes, that's directed by, My boy Zhang Yimou.
Yeah, good director, and it's just, but that's a bad movie.
That's another one I kind of got a soft spot.
There's moments, but it's still
better than this.
It's sure, but that movie's like, yeah. I don't know. That movie, both of these movies are fucking boring. Is the problem? Like,
I like that they're both colorful, and I think, you know, to go back to the sincerity thing that I brought up earlier, I think they're both very sincere a lot of the time, and that has people draw the knives out faster. So even though they are flawed, and I can't really go to bat for them, like, at all, I'm like, I don't know. I've seen worse shit.
I guess. I've
seen significantly worse shit.
Oh, I forgot. This is, like, a compacting thing of, like, there was Exodus in 2014, and then there was Pan in 2015. Remember Pan?
I do. Oh, I have another thing about that movie.
And that was...
That first trailer is really good.
For Pan?
I think the first trailer.
I don't remember any of the marketing for Pan.
I do. It brought me like a sense of wonder and awe, and I was like, "What am I feeling?" And then eventually, I saw the movie, and I was like, "What the fuck happened?" And apparently, Joe Wright asked himself the same thing. I think that one got away from him a little bit.
Well, Joe Wright gave that interview recently when he was promoting Cyrano, which is a movie that got, like, totally bungled by its release. Like, mm-hmm. someone should go to prison over how poorly that movie was released. But he gave that interview where he talked about, like, how difficult, like, especially The Woman in the Window, like, how that got away from him and how much of a disaster that movie was.
Yeah, that one's sad.
Yeah.
Because I actually kind of like it.
You like The Woman in the Window?
It's for me and the Wine Moms, yeah.
But I don't even think Wine Moms like it. Like, they like
the, I don't know.
They like the book.
Movie night at my house, everyone.
All right.
We'll just get our big bottles of wine.
But hey, I guess Lionsgate and Alex Proyas initially issued an apology, to which Ava DuVernay responded for some reason. This kind of apology never happens for something that happens all the time. An unusual occurrence worth noting.
That's her quote?
That's her quote.
Oh, okay.
Which is just interesting. A lot of people are like, wow, we can't believe they apologized, which is like a weird take.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, and then like later, Proyas like, was like rambling on his Facebook page. And he said, like, they ripped this movie because they were trying to look politically correct. Like, he said that's why critics came down hard on it.
Oh, yeah, not because it's like a mess.
Not because it's fucking bad.
Yeah.
But, you know, he hasn't made a movie since.
Yeah, I think his extremely online tendencies are kind of like an insight into how maybe he's not a great guy to like want to work with all the time.
Yeah. Although the one guy here was in Dark City.
Oh yeah, the set's architect, right?
Yeah. The master builder.
Yeah, he falls down the big thing.
Yeah, he built a trap that was, like, easy to actually get around.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that's another thing. Like, they try to do, like, some quirky, like punchlines and stuff like that with that kid, Beck, played by Brenton Thwaites. Thwaites?
Sure.
He's Nightwing on Titans right now.
Oh, is that show good?
I don't know. I just know he's on it.
That was just the one.
Sorry.
That was the one where the trailer was like, "Fuck Batman." Remember that?
Yeah.
And I was like, "I'm good. Like, yeah, I'm watching enough things right now."
I was like the Arrow defender, and even I was like, "I don't know about this one."
Like, maybe it's fine. Maybe it's like super great, but I'm also like, there's probably other things worth my time a little.
Yeah,
more.
Yeah. He's it's on a. It's about to see have its fourth season produced right now. We'll see if that
we'll see
because of the change-ups. But anyways, he's getting like some one-liners in this that I know he's not like quipping or anything like that. Or he's not.
He's not
like making it up as like he's not improvising.
Yeah.
They're clearly written and they just don't work.
And it's not. It doesn't feel like the Marvel quips at least. So
yeah,
it
yeah,
wasn't,
they
like,
just fall flat.
Terrible. It's just like not good. I also liked the girl in it.
Is that Elodie Young?
Yep.
Oh, yeah,
no,
she's
no,
great.
No. Elodie Young, she's great, but also Courtney Eaton, who played the love interest.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And then she was Cheeto the Fragile in
Fury
Road.
And what's her
name?
Abby Lee's also in this.
Yes, but like a much smaller role.
Yes. She kind of has like very few lines.
Mm-hmm.
But hey... I don't know. This movie's a mess. This movie's just like, there's not really much to talk about other than like, why do we keep trying to do these movies with like gods and stuff? They never seem to work.
You know, it seems to work in like animation more than anything.
Yeah.
I feel like that's where this stuff kind of like can flourish, not just visually, but like storytelling wise, because a big part of the background criticism and Proyas' defense of it is that, like, it's a fantasy version. It's not Egypt that actually existed. And it's like, yeah, we know that, idiot.
Yeah. We're not coming here being like, dude, why isn't this accurate? Like,
yeah, like, that's not the complaint.
And it's not like he pulled, like, a Kenneth Branagh thing where, like, Kenneth Branagh will, like, cast, like, the most diverse cast on the planet. And it's like, are these people are supposed to be brothers and they're, like, completely different. Kenneth Branagh's like, it doesn't matter. Like, it's not like, it's not like he did that. It's a mostly white cast is the
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, it's like you put Jeffrey Rush as Ra. Like.
I forgot.
Yeah. Like,
he gets so big.
He gets big and he, like, hits his chest and there's flames. I actually really like that sequence.
It's fun and it's just like, I mean, it's like it's where Gerard Butler gets to go ham with him too, and they're like really good together. Mm-hmm. He's like, I don't want to die, I want to live, and yeah. I'm like, I like totally believe like his like plight right yeah. now. Yeah,
but I did like Ra shooting at Apophis, like the giant serpent. Like that was like, and like we see the Earth is flat in that shot.
Yeah,
which I'm like, all right, this kind of rules for at least a few minutes, like. That's the thing. I honestly, I sat down and I'm watching it, and like the opening narration is bad, right? Like, mm-hmm. where it's just like, they're like, oh, did you know gods have gold blood? And it's like, why are you telling me this? Like, please don't bother. It's like, oh, did you know that gods are actually really tall? And I'm like, oh, I wouldn't have put that together if you just visually showed me that, I guess. Mm-hmm. And it's like, the narration's bad. But then, like, I'm watching it, and I'm like, also, first of all, I think I mentioned this on the other podcast. When we originally agreed to do this, I thought Diego was talking about Exodus Gods and Kings. It's like, sure, another Ridley Scott, why not? And then I was like, oh no, it's Gods of Egypt. So I'm watching this, and then I realize I haven't actually seen this movie. I didn't see it when it came out.
Mm.
And so I'm like, oh, okay, let's watch this. And I'm like, kind of like, oh man, this might actually be good. Like, it's kind of interesting. It's weird, but like in a fun way, you know? And I'm like, this is kind of interesting. And then, like, the first action scene kicks in, and I'm like, oh, nope, it's bad. Like, it just immediately deflates once, not Gerard Butler's fault, but, like, once he shows up and, like, starts betraying people, it just does, like, it's like, oh, this is bad.
Yeah. And I try not to be what we refer to as script watchers, but, you know, when he's, like, overthrowing the kingdom, and it's like, there are all these gods here who are, like, loyal to the king. They can all do the big god thing.
Yeah.
They could just... Could they not just fight him?
And it's like Chadwick Boseman's right there and just like, eh,
oh,
whatever.
God, yeah.
As tough. Look, he's having fun.
Yeah.
As the god of wisdom.
He's having a great time. Miss him every day.
Yeah.
What a star. I think he rides the wavelength of like almost camp that the movie needed everyone else to lock into, and they just like can't. You know?
Well, here's the thing. I don't think there's really any bad performances in this. It's just the
movie. No. I should say that, too. Yeah. Good. It's no one's fault in the acting department.
But they clearly wanted Boseman to be the guy where it's like, shit has been kind of intense up to this point, and then you meet Chad Boseman, and he's like, oh, he's kind of a sillier character, you know? Like, mm-hmm. And he's like, oh, you come and bother me with such petty things? Like, he's talking like that. And it's fun, but like I said, the movie's just not... great. It's going to be this sad thing, though, where, like, Chadwick Boseman now is... There's going to be, like, Chadwick Boseman completists for, like, the rest of his life, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, for the rest of time, it's just... They're going to watch everything, so there's going to be people out there who are probably going to be like... You know, he shows up in Gods of Egypt for 5 minutes, and now you have to watch Gods of Egypt. Such a shame. How fucking... Ugh.
Yeah.
Fucking...
Yeah, it's... Terrible. It's no good.
Mm-hmm. Terrible. Terrible. Remember when he didn't win that Oscar? Oof. Good job, Academy.
And it was the last category.
I know. They so set themselves. And didn't they announce like a Chadwick Boseman NFT or some insane shit?
They did. And everyone was like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Oh my god, he voiced T'Challa on What If?
Yeah.
Oh, I did not know that. Holy shit.
Yeah. So I will watch those eventually. At least those
books. I don't know if I could even, like, bring myself to do it. Like, that would upset...
It looks so bad.
That would upset me a lot. Like,
well, it's his last performance.
Yeah.
That's what, like, stinks it, you know?
Mm-hmm. And, damn. That was an awful, like, no one knew, but there was, like, that awful, like, year before his death where people were like... Man, Chadwick Boseman looks tired. He must be sick of being Black Panther. You remember that shit?
I do remember that.
That rubbed me the wrong way at the time. And it's like, why do you care, man? Mm-hmm. And then it's like, oh, it turned out he was fucking battling colon cancer. Like, the fuck, people?
Yeah, it was really gross.
Guy can't look fucking tired? Only 43, man.
Yeah, it's... God, I remember when that happened. I was like, fuck. Like, that whole day, everyone just like, you just felt it in the air. It was a bad year. It was 2020.
Yeah.
But that one, like, that, like, a weight shifted, like, in the Hollywood world.
Mm-hmm.
You just kind of felt it.
And it was one of those ones where, like, when it came out, it was like, like that didn't happen. Like there was like an hour I think where I was like, that can't be accurate. Like something else happened. And then like once it became clear that it like did, it was like, the fuck, really? Mm-hmm. And it was like right after the Five Bloods came out. Like I remember having just watched, it felt like I had just watched it. Like, and I was like, oh, he's really good in it. And then it's like, fuck. It is that thing of like him fucking, the kid who played Chekhov on Star Trek.
Oh, Anton Yelchin.
Anton Yelchin. Those two guys, it was like, they felt like we were just seeing the beginnings of like a really great careers.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And like both of them cut short. Just awful. Just. It's just so weird. It like it's an, like this movie was already tainted, and like now to just watch it and be like, I can't watch this. Like it makes me sad, man. Like
yeah. And hey, both these guys have supporting roles in 2016 blockbusters. Anton Yelchin kind of gets the better one with Star Trek Beyond. Yeah, obviously.
Did that come out after his death? I can't even remember.
It did.
Yeah.
It did. Yeah. He died earlier that year.
God damn. What a fucked up year.
I mean, know.
Like, not that, like, years have been better, but, like, goddamn. Fucking shit just going off the rails, man.
Hey, but Moonlight won the Oscar.
Hey, that is, like, that was one of those moments where it's like, oh, hey, the right movie won.
Yeah, like, the exact right one.
Yeah. The movie that baffled Max Landis.
Oh, yeah, that was pretty funny.
Have you noticed all these movies coming out that don't have three-act structures?
And it's like, no, it clearly does, first of all.
Yeah.
It's like, just not like, it's not a movie that points that out for you very, what? It fucking does, too.
It does, because it's literally does. Like, here's his childhood, here's his teenage years, here's his adult years. Like, it's just that they're all thematic, not physical, you know?
Mm-hmm. And that, like, broke his brain. And yeah. You know what? Like, fuck that guy, too. But that's still a problem I find with, like, other writers, too. They're like, they kind of struggle with stuff that doesn't, like, adhere to a perfectly physical narrative.
Yeah, they want a physical thing. I'm so fucking lucky. It's honestly pure luck. I'm just lucky that I saw No Country for Old Men in theaters when I did. You know? Because that's a movie that has a three-act structure, but it zigs when you think it's going to zag, you know? Like,
yeah.
But it does have a conventional structure, and it's just, it challenged me enough to be like, that had to have been done for a reason, as opposed to coming out of it being like, wow, they fucked up the ending, which I feel like other people might do. If had that movie come out like a little later, that would have been the response to that movie. But
yeah, that's like the one Coen Brothers movie that came out exactly when it needed to.
Yeah.
Everyone's like, a little late, a little before.
Yeah. Well, The True Grit made like $100 million.
Okay, that one and True Grit then. Those are Inside Llewyn Davis, maybe.
They haven't, like I said, I was like, well, we should do another Coen Brothers after fucking The Hudsucker Proxy, but they really haven't directed that many bombs. Like, even The Ladykillers made money.
God, that's fucking crazy to me.
Intolerable Cruelty made money. Like, that's nuts.
That makes sense, though, with George Clooney and Catherine Zeta-Jones, and like, you know, just look
I
at
I guess
them.
At the height of their power, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
What about The Man Who Wasn't There? Man Who Wasn't There bombed, so.
Okay, oh, it's so fucking good.
We can do that one.
Fuck yeah.
One of the weirder Coen Brothers movies.
Yeah, but it's so fun.
It is great. I think I've asked you this, but when True Grit came out, did you see that in theaters?
I don't think I did, no.
When I went, there was a fuck ton of children at the screening for True Grit.
Really?
Like, families decided, like, True Grit, let's go. And, I mean, you know, hopefully those kids are going to grow up to be interesting people because they saw a really good movie. But, like, that's a movie where a guy gets shot, like, point blank in the head after cutting a dude's fingers off. It's also, like, fucking Jeff Bridges being like, the whole movie.
Oh, yeah, like, you can't, like, understand him at all. But you're also like, fuck yeah, dude. I totally get what you're saying.
That's one of those, like, classic Oscars. They gave Jeff Bridges the Oscar a year too early. Because they give him that Oscar for Crazy Heart, which no one really remembers.
Yeah.
And then the next year he does True Grit, and it's like, that's the movie he should have gotten the Oscar for.
Yeah. Like, you know what? He's kind of like Chewbacca in True Grit. You can't really understand him,
yeah,
but everyone else does.
Yeah. I do not know this man. That was my favorite line in that whole movie. they cut the body down, and he just looks at it and just goes, I do not know this man.
Back to 2016. Let's take a look at what else happened. Civil War came out, which is the worst Marvel movie.
A guy who will eventually give nuclear secrets to the Saudis will be elected president.
Yeah, that also happened. The Nice Guys bombed.
Nice Guys bombed because it came out right around Captain America: Civil War.
Yeah. Fantastic. The first Fantastic Beasts entry in the saga comes out later that year.
We didn't figure out where to find them. That was the problem with that movie.
Yeah.
Is J.K. X-Men Rowling Apocalypse? Is J.K. transphobic by this point?
Yes, I don't remember if we know.
But well, here's the thing.
I think we do.
There was a weird, like, people are kind of like, you know, the sexual politics of the Harry Potter books are kind of weird. And then J.K. Rowling, like, liked a transphobic tweet. Do you remember this?
I don't remember the exact order of events, but...
No, I remember the exact order.
Okay.
I just don't know when. Like, she liked it and then released a statement saying, like, it was a senior moment. I didn't realize what I was liking was transphobic. Like, that she actually released the statement that said that. And then later she just kind of goes full mask off and she released that op-ed called Turf Wars.
Remember? Oh, fuck.
And that was
right.
That was the moment where it's like, okay, like, she's not accidentally kind of rubbing elbows with other feminists who are TERFs. She is a TERF.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the moment when it was like, okay, it's unambiguous. And I can't remember if it happens before or after the Crimes of Grindelwald. Because I remember when Crimes of Grindelwald came out, people were kind of petitioning Rowling herself to do something about the Johnny Depp thing. And then I think around that time was when the transphobic stuff came out. And then that's when the backlash kind of kicked in.
Then she was like, oh, I'm just a big fan of Johnny Depp. And apparently she's such a huge fan, she like fought against the studio to try to keep him.
Yeah. I bet you she's like, that's why whatever the fuck the last movie was called didn't do as well as we wanted.
Oh, because Johnny Depp's not in it.
Yeah. Even though you got a much better actor.
Yeah, it's like no competition.
Yeah, you know, like that's, you know, not to. Who knows?
We're not stirring the coals by saying Johnny Depp hasn't been good in a movie.
Yeah, that was the thing I was gonna say. Like, who knows about Johnny Depp and his personal life? That's up for interpretation. But what is objective is Johnny Depp hasn't made a good movie in over a decade. Like, that's just the objective fact at this point.
Yeah,
and you know. That doesn't
And that mean... wasn't controversial to say a decade ago. Like, no. We all knew it. People didn't like the pirate sequels at
People
first.
People didn't like the pirate sequels, especially the last one where he's very clearly phoning it in and, like, is getting his lines...
You know what? I'm even going back to the first two sequels when it was a trilogy.
Well,
you know?
Yeah, but those are, like, bad movies. But he's
fine. No, those are incredible blockbusters, but, like...
If you cut... Here's the thing. You gotta... The first Pirates, you gotta cut 20 minutes. Second Pirates, you gotta cut 40 minutes. Third Pirates got to cut 80 minutes, and then they would be good movies. The third one is kind of representative, though, of, like, peak Johnny Depp, because that's a movie where, like, there's a whole sequence where it's just multiple Johnny Depps.
Yeah, yeah. And that is, those are sequels that they kind of, like, made up on the fly as well,
mm-hmm.
which is probably explains some of their sagginess, but I kind of
Here's the thing. When they're good, they're good. When they're bad, they're a fucking train wreck. So,
it's... I don't agree with that. But I do think
so
the follow-up sequels to them
boring
are train wrecks.
In moments. There's just some sequences in those movies.
Well, here's the thing. To compare to 2016 around Gods of Egypt cinema at the time, right? Versus someone like Gore Verbinski, who did have a movie come out, at least in some film festivals in 2016, Cure for Wellness, Gore Verbinski can direct the shit out of, like, so much. Versus, like, I don't know, just pulling films out of a hat here. I don't know, The Suicide Squad, right?
This is maybe the highest grossing worst... film of 2016.
Was it?
Yep.
Not so, Civil War or Rogue One?
It's 10th highest grossing.
Oh, I thought you said the highest grossing.
No,
that
no,
scared the
no.
shit out of me. I
that
would have
like,
oh, been. We've been dead for like 6 years now.
Yeah, we died this all those years ago.
Yeah.
At the fucking screenplay factory when it exploded they were trying to re-edit the movie. It was too dangerous. It took all of Hollywood with it.
Yeah, they ran out of paper, so they had to print it on melted anthrax.
Yes, exactly. They used the nuclear codes to finish Suicide Squad.
What are these numbers in the middle of the page? Oh, don't worry about that. Let me see that. Thanks. No. I'll just take that one.
The guy who owns Mar-a-Lago said he didn't need them.
Just excuse me as I hand these over to enemies of the state.
Yeah. The guys who are probably directly connected to the 9/11 attacks, I'm just going to give them nuclear codes. Also, no one's going to be that angry about it for some reason. Like,
yeah, what, I'm having a stroke just thinking about
cause
it.
It's because they're trying to stop him from running again, Diego. That's all it is. Which is probably true, to be honest. Yeah. They probably really are trying to stop him from running for president again. But he did do this. Like, he did also do it. I think, actually, you know what? I read a really interesting take that it was probably Kushner that did it. And Trump just, like, didn't know. Because if you had told Trump we're giving nuclear codes to the Saudis, Trump would have just said it in, like, an interview. Like, he didn't know. Oh. He doesn't know how to not admit to crimes. Like,
yeah. And if anyone who hears that thinks that might be, like, a wild accusation Mac Ringo just made, remember that day with the eclipse when everyone was like, oh, you can only look with the sunglasses, the special sunglasses, and he just looks up at it without the sunglasses, and everyone's like, Mr. President, no!
No, he can hear people yelling.
That. Like, that's his entire ethos as a human being.
Because
he has none.
He's, like, the tragic thing about the most evil man on Earth is that he's, like, got, like, a stunted development, you know? Mm-hmm. He's that poor kid that got probably fucking tortured when he went away to boarding school and had a father who didn't love him, you know? He's never progressed by that moment. They talk about if you don't have that stability at a young age, you're just mentally always at that age forever until you figure out how to find stability, you know? Mm-hmm. And he never found it. He thought he could find it by painting everything gold, and he just couldn't find it. Yeah. He literally got to the most, he became the most powerful person on Earth, and it didn't make him happy. It'd be tragic if he wasn't actively destroying Western democracy.
Yeah, yeah.
Gods of Egypt.
Gods of Egypt. Other movies I just want to reference that came out in 2016. Arrival, which I you just told me people don't like. I thought everyone
Arrival
liked it.
Now, I don't know what happened.
I don't know, but it was kind of a terrible year for blockbusters. Yeah. Apart from, like, the one I just mentioned, like Star Trek Beyond.
Which kind of bombed.
Kind of bombed. Oh, but, like, I remember I took two people who hadn't seen a single moment of Star Trek before in their lives to it. Because I wanted to watch it. And I missed it opening weekend. And they both really liked it. Mm-hmm. So, like, it worked. Like, for what it was going for, it worked. And just no one fucking saw it.
It was sad. It was just, it's probably the J.J. Abrams thing of, like, fucking up the sequel. And then, like, where do you go from here now?
Yeah.
J.J. Abrams has rebooted and killed more franchises.
The only one that worked reboot-wise was Mission Impossible 3. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't a sequel to his own movie. And then he didn't do any of
the
other
ones. And that movie, like, was considered, like, kind of a disappointment at the time. Mm-hmm. Like, it underperformed at the time. And then later, it kind of, like, it became the template for the future movies.
Yeah.
Hey, remember The Secret Life of Pets?
Oh my god, is that when that came out for the first time?
Yeah, it came out 2016. Louis C.K. in a children's film.
Sorry.
Just to show you where we were at as a culture.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and Sausage Party.
Oh my god, Sausage Party. Fuck.
Remember that?
Yeah. I mean, you know what? I've never seen it, though.
It's not good. You won't like it.
I didn't think I would. Oh, they did the Angry Birds movie. That was that year. Yeah. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Out of the Shadows.
You know what? Fun movie.
Yeah, but it's also a movie that just doesn't exist. Like, people remember that they made a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie. No one remembers that there was a sequel made to it.
I know. It's fucking... That's another fucking problem. I believe Scott Mendelson from Forbes calls it the Tomb Raider problem. Funny, we just talked about that too. Where the first one, everyone decided to see, it's bad. The second one, marginally or significantly better or at least entertaining, worth watching, but no one goes to watch it because they got burnt by the first time.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, though, aside from the movies, might be one of the most successful franchises ever made.
Yeah, they can't get the movies to work consistently
at
all.
But they've had, at this point, they have had five series. and four of them have been hits. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of wild.
Yeah, I like it. The Turtles. I got into them late too. I'm getting in. I'm discovering a lot about my youth on this episode.
Well, I think the thing is,
on a lot of stuff.
I think the thing that happens is they go Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles are great. You have to start with the '87 cartoon, and you watch it, and it's an '80s cartoon. It's like, this isn't very good.
Yeah, it's like, then, no, you don't.
Yeah, start with like the 2003 one or the 2012 one or whatever the fuck, or don't at all. It doesn't matter. Nothing matters.
Yeah.
Hey. The Secret of the Ooze. I saw That's X-Men Apocalypse
movie.
In theaters.
I did too.
Does Olivia Munn have any lines in that movie?
I don't think so.
That's weird.
That's super weird, especially because, like, on paper, it's like, oh, you could play Psylocke, this badass with swords and shit. Or you could play Deadpool's girlfriend.
Yeah, and she, like, actually did a shit ton of sword training for the movie. Like, that was, like, one of those things that came out. And she's, like, barely in the goddamn thing.
Yeah, and I'm willing to bet it's that director not knowing how to handle an ensemble.
Yeah.
What
is that guy's deal as a director? Like...
He's very hands-off. Maybe wrong choice of words, I'm sorry. But, like, he's very...
But, like, he's got the usual suspects, right?
Yeah. He doesn't, like, really guide the ship directing-wise. Like, you know, there's reports coming out of him, like, abandoning the set of Apocalypse.
Okay.
For, like, what we gonna rightfully assume are, like, evil reasons, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
But he does that, like, on all of his projects.
Yeah.
That's not a defense of it, obviously. I'm saying, like, no, he's not the one making these movies,
but why does X-Men 2 work?
Does it?
X-Men 2 is a great movie. I'm sorry. X-Men 2 is a really good movie.
Right group of people, I guess. Because, like, here's the thing.
If only... People that
love
movie...
Days of Future Past. Very few people love Apocalypse, if any.
Yeah.
And it's kind of the same people.
That's weird, but Days of Future Past also isn't good.
I don't like it. I'm just saying, like... People
a waste
something comes together on them without his like know-how. And here's the thing I'll say about X-Men Apocalypse. I actually think the color grade is like really good for some reason.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why it is so good in that movie. It's so like poppy and comic booky. It has the utterly insane moment where Magneto destroys Auschwitz.
Oh yeah.
Which is just like you are not the people to talk about, like to confront that. And the first half hour is genuinely entertaining for how fucking insane it is.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, it just nosedives into generic bad territory.
I think the problem is that Apocalypse is just a bad character. Like, you can't really do much with that guy.
He's kind of a one-off episode in a series, you know? Yeah. It's like, oh, this is the first, you could maybe a three-episode arc in a series, right? This is the first X-Men, or the first mutant, and... It's like, believe in survival of the fittest sucks. And shit.
You know what X-Men 2 is good? It's Brian Cox.
Oh, yeah.
Brian Cox rules in that movie.
Oh, yeah, he's terrific.
When he's just like, the jet appears to come up out of the basketball courts. Like, that, like his delivery of that line is so good. Oh my God. Yeah, shame about that, man.
Yes. Sorry about that. We just diverged super hard
into X-Men Conjuring territory. 2. Is 2016.
I like The Conjuring too.
I don't like any of those movies, but
I know. I remember.
Finding Dory, which I did see in theaters, because it was one of those years where I just needed to talk to my childhood a little bit. It's not very good. It's okay. It's like entirely fine, you know.
Yeah, I like Andrew Stanton enough to like be there for whatever he does next.
And it's that thing of like there's the Pixar problem that I think we're hitting now, where like their movies are mostly just fine, mm-hmm. and it's like you gotta be better than that because you're starting to like dilute like your other movies with how fine your movies are being.
Yeah.
Warcraft,
which I definitely go to bat for.
I go to bat for Warcraft too. I saw that in theaters.
Same.
And. At first, I kind of came out of it, like, not sure how I felt, and then I'm, like, literally in, like, the lobby of the movie theater, and these kids are running around, like, acting out the movie that they just saw, and I was like, okay, 5 stars. Like, those kids clearly loved it.
Uh-huh.
Jason Bourne.
Oh, fuck.
Remember Jason Bourne?
Yeah.
Oh my God, it's Jason Bourne.
Do you know... I'm sorry, we're completely off Gods of Egypt now, but do you know why that movie exists?
No, I don't. Is the Bourne Legacy? Do you know
why the previous Bourne movie exists? Probably the one without Jason Bourne.
Because of a rights thing?
Yes. So, the original run of Bourne movies, you know, it starts, it doesn't start with Paul Greengrass. It starts with...
with another guy.
The other guy who made a good movie, yeah. The Bourne Identity.
That was right? Also a movie that famously, like, they had to redo half of it because it was filmed before 9/11 but released after. So, like, they had to, like, reshoot, like, a shit ton of that first movie.
Yes, Doug Liman. Okay. And Doug Liman, he's made plenty of great movies. I'm a fan.
Fairly competent kind of filmmaker.
He kind of finds the movie in the shooting and then in the edit. And sometimes that works, sometimes it doesn't. It worked very well with Bourne Identity. I think it worked great with something like Edge of Tomorrow.
Didn't work with Chaos Walking.
You know, it works sometimes, other times it doesn't. Mm-hmm. But the films were written by Tony Gilroy. And Tony Gilroy and Paul Greengrass were kind of in of two minds of where to take the franchise, basically. Mm-hmm. And how to, like, write these narratives. So by the end, Ultimatum...
I forgot Tony Gilroy directed Legacy. Oh, my God.
Yes, that's okay. Why he directs Legacy, to kind of steal it back away from Paul Greengrass, because Tony Gilroy doesn't really write Bourne Ultimatum. Mm-hmm. He is credited, and he wrote on it. But the finished film is, like, kind of just the other writers.
Did he write Supremacy?
He did write Supremacy.
Supremacy is the really good one.
I love Ultimatum. Supremacy is, like, a perfect movie.
Yeah.
It's flawless.
I think I've said, like, I'm not the biggest Bourne fan. Like, they're not, mm-hmm. like great movies to me. Like, they're good. They just don't really appeal to me. But the one I really like is Supremacy. And you know why?
It's got the greatest fucking car chase you've ever seen.
That, but Brian Cox is also in Bourne Supremacy.
That's right. I think I just unlocked the key to Macaringo. It's fucking put Brian Cox in
everything. Brian Cox was one of those guys where, like, I'm a kid watching X-Men 2, and I'm like, I like this guy.
Yeah, like, so, who the fuck is this guy?
All you Supremacy heads out there, Secession heads out there, who now love him. Like, I was on Team Brian Cox way early, so...
Yeah, but yeah, so that's why Gilroy's basically not part of the finished film of Ultimatum, mm-hmm. Which is why the writing is, like, a mess, but Greengrass' direction is, like, just perfect.
Yeah, like, sure.
Supremacy is all around, like, the most well-refined, but Ultimatum is, like, a masterpiece of action direction.
If you ever run into my father out in the wild randomly by chance, ask him to do his impression of Albert Finney in the Bourne Ultimatum.
Okay.
He just does
your
one...
Your name is David Webb.
No, he just does the one line where he goes, "He's coming home." For some reason, he just does it, and it's the funniest thing I've ever heard. So.
Yeah, Tony Gilroy does Bourne Legacy as, like, a rebuke to Paul Greengrass.
Oh, no.
And so Paul Greengrass is like, "Motherfucker, I'll show you. I'll bring the franchise back. I'm bringing Matt Damon back." And then we all watch it and we're like, what the fuck happened?
Yeah. Wow. It's kind of a classic, like, when they're separated, like, the two guys that clash, like, but once you separate them, like, it doesn't work, you know? Mm-hmm. Wow. That's
look,
wow.
The movie, everyone knows the movie was so poorly received that I only had this from secondhand accounts. I guess the Bourne ride at the Universal
it's an action show. It's like a stunt show.
Okay, now correct me if I'm wrong, because in the Jason
Bourne I have not seen it because it, like, only do it, like, twice a day because no one
okay
cares.
okay. Well, in the Jason Bourne film from 2016, mm-hmm. Nikki Parsons, played by Julia Stiles, is killed off, and everyone's like, why the fuck did
do that?
In the Bourne Stuntacular, they actually reveal that she went underground in order to keep
it's canon.
Her distance from Jason.
It's canon.
So they know they fucked it up so bad that, like, we can't leave.
They put
it
in the ride.
They put it in the ride to, like, save face.
Wow. That was a bad decision.
That was a horrible decision.
That was she's kind of like the one person you don't want to see that happen to.
Yeah, like, also, you just fucking did it for the woman from the first movie.
Yeah, it's that thing of, like, they're like, well, what will get Jason Bourne back in it? It's like, you gotta kill a woman, I guess.
Like, yeah, and it's just like, no, we move past that. We don't do that anymore. We don't do that here. But they did.
Why did they do the same gag in ultimatum that they did in Supremacy, where there's like Jason Bourne's on the phone with them, and they're talking, and like then he says something that was like he makes a comment. And he's like she's like he's like put what's his name on the phone. She's like he's not here. He's like yeah he's there. He's standing right next to you. And they're like holy shit he's watching us right. Mm-hmm. And he's looking through the sniper rifle, and then they do the same gag in Ultimatum, where he's like. We should have a meeting. And she's like, I'm at my office. Like, no, you're not. I'm in your office right now. Why'd they do the same fucking gag?
Probably because they did kind of have to make up that one on the fly. Something about Blockbusters in 2007. They were just making shit up. Like Spider-Man 3.
Yeah.
At World's End, Pirates of the Caribbean. Like, something was, like, happening to Hollywood.
Someone realized.
They just had to fucking cobble shit together. And like, it worked sometimes.
Because all those franchises, all those movies, Spider-Man, Pirates of the Caribbean and the Bourne movies were all franchises that studios were like, I don't know, it might make money, right? Mm-hmm. Like, they famously thought Pirates was going to bomb. Like, everyone was, because no pirate movie had ever made money up to that point. And then it was like a massive hit. And once it becomes a hit, and once it looks like the sequels will also be hit, that's when all the studio guys come in and have a bunch of notes. Because now it's about maximizing the amount of money you can get out of a movie. And that's what leads to a lot of making up on the fly. Also 2016, Sully.
I like Sully.
The last story that made me feel good about America.
The last good Clint Eastwood movie.
Did you see Cry Macho?
I did not.
It's a shame Clint Eastwood died 3 years before they started filming. But I think he gave a great performance anyway. That was mean. I apologize, Clint Eastwood.
No, you don't.
Not really.
Yeah, you're good. All right, Exodus, Gods, and Kings. Matt, would you recommend it?
That's how he talked that whole movie. Wait, The Magnificent Seven was also 2016.
Oh, man, that was a nothing year for, like, big movies.
The Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. Another movie where someone just, like, casually asked Tim Burton in interviews, like, hey, why are all the kids white in the movie? And Tim Burton was like, why do people always want cast to be diverse? Like, I remember when they had a diverse character on a show I watched as a kid, they fucked the whole show up. People were like, whoa, where'd this come from, Tim? Like,
and now he's on Netflix doing the Wednesday Addams Show, and he's like, oh, see, I cast colored people.
Which feels like it's been in production for about 7 years at this point.
Yeah.
The Girl on the Train. Remember that? The Tate Taylor movie?
That fucking hack, yeah.
Remember that movie?
Oh my god, yeah.
I'm looking at all the number one movies of that year.
The Handmaiden came out that year, too.
Yeah, but that's a great movie and, like, was barely released.
yeah, but I'm saying, like, this the smaller stuff, smaller.
It's a great year for tiny movies. It's a bad year for fucking anything that was released. Why? Yeah.
Oh, for other people curious, because these are a bunch of my favorites, stuff like Jackie.
I still haven't seen Jackie.
I think you'd like Jackie.
I should have watched it before we did JFK.
Yeah, maybe. All right, Jackie.
To see how that movie was part of the cover-up.
No. Jackie, Hunt for the Wilder People, which I've talked about, really going to bat for.
I really hope that director goes places.
Green Room.
This movie, I will say, Green Room's fantastic.
Green Room's fucking great.
It'll make you feel miserable when you watch it, but it's great. This Gods of Egypt kind of reminded me a lot of Thor, Love and Thunder.
No!
Yeah, it really did.
That's a shame.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
Some actual comedies I think are, like, really underappreciated. Edge of 17, which is, like, a coming-of-age one, too.
That's a solid movie.
Neighbors 2, I think, is fucking hysterical.
The Neighbors movies are kind of underrated.
They're super underrated. There are some fucking gags in there that kill me like nothing else. How to Be Single, which is, like, I think a great movie, period. I don't know if you've seen it.
I have not seen that one.
Okay, no one talks about it anymore. I'm like, why aren't we talking about this movie all the time?
What year was Dope?
Remember the 2015?
Movie Dope? I like that movie. No one seems to talk about it.
I like Dope a lot, too.
Yeah, no one seems to talk about it that much.
I don't know. Rick Famuyiwa is, like, so talented. He does the best episodes of The Mandalorian alongside Bryce Dallas Howard. Yeah. So, like, what the fuck?
Maybe they're grooming him to be a Star Wars guy. I hope that's not what they're doing with those directors, though.
Like, I feel like this is that's exactly what they're doing. Yeah. But also, he's just clearly such a talented dude, and he was going to do The Flash way back when, and maybe that's a good thing he didn't.
Yeah, maybe he's like, wow, dodged a fucking bullet.
Yeah.
He dodged a bullet like The Flash would dodge a bullet. You get it, because he runs so fast.
I got it.
That's his superpower. He runs really fast. Took him fucking 40 years to make a Flash movie.
Yeah, I know. What is that, huh? The show will have gone on for 9 seasons by the time the movie comes out. Wow. The show started and ended from when the movie was announced and completed and released.
Goddamn. I guess this guy taking over can't do any worse than the guys that were already in charge.
I guess. Oh, Kubo and the Two Strings also came out in 2016. That's the last one I'm going to mention because that's like my favorite movie from that year.
That's a really solid movie.
It makes me cry a lot. All the time.
Like Weird Company.
Weird Company. They should keep making movies. Also, let your workers unionize.
Yeah, that's... Anyways. Yeah, that's probably... but also, from that year, The Accountant.
People like that movie.
Remember The Accountant? Okay. Another... You know what? It feels like... I'm not saying it was, like, wrong for people. That, like, I don't want this to come across as being, like, people shouldn't have complained. But it feels like these conversations about, like, representation where it's, like, A, the whitewashing of this movie, and B, The Accountant, where it's, like... His character's, like, kind of autistic, but they make it look like a superpower, right?
Mm-hmm.
This feels like those conversations were really big until the election happened. And then people were like, we gotta focus on other things for a little bit. Yeah. Like, fuck movies.
It kind of feels like we're headed back to that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I feel like those criticisms are popping up more and more again.
Yeah.
About certain movies that are coming out.
Well, because now we have a president that is legally dead. So, like, no one's paying attention to what's happening.
The Clint Eastwood of presidents?
Yeah. Joe Biden gave a great performance in Cry Macho.
Then he just falls over and the cameras are done.
It's just him falling over constantly. We're back to the fucking Gerald Ford era. Isn't it funny? The guy keeps falling over. Did Gerald Ford get shot?
I don't know.
No, Reagan got shot. Sorry.
Didn't he miss?
No, Reagan got hit. No, you know what the weird thing about Reagan was? Fucking Hinckley missed because he was a bad shot. But the car for the president was so armored, the bullets ricocheted off the car and hit Reagan. So that's what almost got him. Like
something out of Wanted.
Yeah, a little bit. They're
curving the bullets to reflect off the bulletproof car.
You know what Reagan said before he went under for surgery?
I actually have no idea.
I hope you're not Democrats. That's allegedly what he said. And then he was...
You know what?
And then when
for a piece of shit, that's pretty funny.
That was the thing. He was funny. That's the problem. Like, I can't deny that Reagan did have some good comedic chops. It's just he was an evil person.
Yeah. Like, have you ever seen that video of, like, Hitler flirting with the woman recording him?
Oh, yeah. I've seen that. Yeah.
Yeah. And that was one of those first Tumblr moments where people started to get really serious about history and the world. But they brought up a good point where it was like, you know, it's uncomfortable to watch, like, a truly evil monster man, like... Mm. Acts human because
yeah, I mean that's
what they are still.
That's a big problem people have today, where it's like they like everyone gets diagnosed with like being a psychopath on YouTube, you know,
mm-hmm.
where it's like you actually have to go through like a lot of like clinical studies to be officially called a psychopath. But we want to believe that people that do awful things have to be like sort of like abnormal, and it's like you would be shocked what the average person could do if they're pushed enough, you know. Mm-hmm. Or just like, or they just don't have a compass in them, which can happen, you know, without abuse at all. Like, but hey, speaking of Donald Trump, also Reagan was like, I want to meet with Hinckley. I want to show him there's no hard feelings. And like the doctors had to be like, no, like you don't understand. He's insane. Like. This will not help. John
Isn't Hinckley doing, like, YouTube videos
yeah,
right now?
Yeah, he released an album. He's out, and he's like, good for you, John Hinckley.
Way to take your shot.
Oh boy, what a guy! What a weird.
The album's a real hole in one.
That doesn't even make sense.
Well, if a bullet goes in,
he blew away the competition.
There you go. Thank you. Yeah.
Also, Moana. This episode had nothing to do with Gods of Egypt. But...
it's not very good. I'm sorry. I can't really go back to it. Moana is one of my favorite Disney movies, though. Go watch Moana.
Yeah.
Watch Moonlight again if you haven't. I know some of you haven't seen it in a while. It holds the fuck up. It's terrific.
I get why you don't want to put it on, but it's actually totally worth putting on.
Yeah, you know, it's one of those movies that's, like, definitely heavy, but, like, I always feel, like elated by the end of it, you know? And it's definitely a movie I watch to, like, kind of like, study, like, the camera movements and stuff like that. Mm. And I also love Trevante Rhodes. I don't know what the fuck is up that Hollywood didn't just scoop that guy up and make him the leading man and everything. Like, he's so clearly
What prejudices could Hollywood have?
No, I mean, I know why. I'm saying, like, you know, this dude just has so much fucking charisma and star power. Like, people were revisiting the Shane Black Predator around Prey's release. Mm-hmm. And, like... I'll defend that movie for myself. I won't recommend it to anyone else. But I do think even, like, Trevante Rhodes is, like, kind of secretly incredible.
No, he is great
in that supporting role.
He is. It's the movie's bad. Like,
yeah, it's like, oh, maybe he should have been the lead.
What was the number one movie when Trump won?
It's probably something fucked up. I don't know. No, you know what? I bet it was something really nice. Like, no.
All right,
ready? It was Utopia.
Boo, a Madea Halloween.
My brain is poisoned.
And then Doctor Strange won the next weekend, so. But yeah, it was Boo, a Madea Halloween.
Oh my god. That was pretty bad.
Remember that movie?
I do. I thought she was going to be fighting monsters or something.
I know. What a ripoff.
I know. I know.
I forgot that, like, Tyler Perry movies are all these, like, weird moralizing things. Like, yeah. But did Madea finally die?
He's bringing her back.
Oh, okay. That lasted all of 2 years, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, whatever, Tyler Perry.
Yeah, a Madea homecoming.
Cool. Does she come back from the dead?
I don't know.
That would be wild. It's weird that
it came out on February 25th of 2022.
It's weird that the first Tyler Perry Madea vehicle is called, like, Diary of a Mad Black Woman, which sounds like it's, like, some heavy shit, and it's, like, got Madea in it. Is that the one where she drives through a fast food chain place? Like, drives into the building and, like, attacks the workers.
Oh my god, I have no idea.
She felt slighted by it.
I actually don't know.
So there you go.
I saw Madea's family reunion.
Oh, how was it?
I laugh when Madea, like, starts slapping a kid.
Yeah.
And she starts saying, didn't your mama teach you any manners?
I hate to admit it, but I do find that about... like, that's something that will just make me laugh.
Yeah.
Just smacking a kid upside the head.
Yeah, you do violence to children in film and fiction. It's pretty funny.
It's for
like,
some
I just
reason.
Saw Body Snatchers, the Abel Ferrara Body
oh,
Snatchers.
Oh, they throw that
the
kid out
screen.
Of the helicopter?
When they throw that kid out of the helicopter, people went ballistic. Like, it was like laughs of relief, thankfully, not mocking. Everyone was really into it. I saw it with the best possible crowd.
Well, because that's like that movie's a fucking nightmare in that third act. Like, that thing is so upsetting. That movie.
And just like it clearly fucked with people so much. People next to me were just like, oh,
you need a release after. Yeah, so I guess the kid getting thrown out of a helicopter is good enough.
Yeah.
There's
these pod screaming at you.
There's this.
Are those the scariest pod people screams?
The original, I mean, the 70s one screams are pretty good.
Those, I mean, oh, yeah. I'm not taking away from any of the other ones. Mm. But this one Maybe just because I saw it in the theater, it was like really,
yeah,
really fucked
up. Goddamn, all of those pod movies fucked me up as a kid. Like, I'm fucked up to this day from those movies.
Yeah.
Like, it's never gotten better. Like, I can lie to myself and be like, nah, I can get to sleep normal. And it's like, no, I can't. And it's like, it's because of those fucking pod people, man. It's fucking... You would think that, like, that the fear of that would wear off after a certain point, and it just doesn't. Like, that's a scary fucking movie.
Yeah. Gods of Egypt.
Gods of Egypt!
Matt, would you recommend White Egypt to people?
Oh, God. no.
I know, I put you in a corner.
No, I wouldn't. There's some sequences in it that are fun. I honestly was, like, watching it, what I kind of... The thing I took away from it was that, like, if I'm ever going to do, like, a fantasy science fiction epic, you use the CGI to do, like, really basic stuff, like landscapes or, like, making people look taller, and then you got to make the action actually look real. Mm-hmm. And don't make that the CGI. Don't do flying. The flying looked really bad in this.
You know what? I actually like the flying. It looked very video gamey. And critic and Twitter pundit, professional shit talker, Vice Victus, brought up a good point that I really agree with. He was saying, like, a bunch of, like, white people were going crazy about this movie because it's so, like, wacky and goofy. Mm-hmm. And it's like, fucking video games do this stuff all the time.
That was my other take, is that this would have worked as a video game.
Yeah.
Because it is so much of, like, go here, get the thing, to do the thing, to finish the thing, like... It is such a, like, Prince of Persia type video game.
Mm-hmm.
And it would have worked as that, not a movie. So maybe that's where all the special effects shit really went. Like, it's just, they're all video games now.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I'm fine with, honestly. Like,
yeah, like, all the AAA stuff is kind of in a rut right now, trying to, like, they're all just doing kind of the same stuff.
They all want
to
be the Last of Us, and, like, that's a bad thing to copy. Like, even, yeah. Like, regardless of what you think of the Last of Us, just let the Last of Us... be the Last of Us.
Yeah, I don't want other games to be that, which is kind of what God of War turned into, which sucks because the original God of War stuff was this, basically. Mm-hmm. You know, just yeah. More violent.
I'm sure you could find a way to do both if you knew what you were doing.
Oh, sure, yeah. And it's not like the new God of War game was bad. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about the 2018 one. I haven't played the Ragnarok. But, like, it's not bad. It's just, like,
But that's like those Dead Rising sequels where, like, they all got, like, super serious after the first one. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you forget it's a game about, like, you can pick up literally any object and hit a zombie with it. And, like, you can put your guy in, like, a dress and have him run around. And, like, the video game cutscenes will keep him in whatever goofy outfit you're in, you know? Like,
yeah,
You can't have a serious plot on top of that. And,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, they straight up try to turn Dead Rising 4 into, like, a Last of Us ripoff. And
I never played that fourth one.
It's bad. Aww. It's very bad. That's the one where they, like, tried to turn Frank West into Bruce Campbell. You know?
Mm.
Which, like, A, it misunderstands Bruce Campbell, and B, it misunderstands the appeal of Frank West. Which is, like, Frank is kind of like a cipher, you know? You can project whatever you want onto him, you know?
Yeah.
And it's fun either way. It hits this perfect... Dead Rising's kind of a perfect video game.
You talking about it just reminded me how much fun I had with that game.
I might do a stream of it sometime this week.
All right.
I might finally go back to streaming. And I'm going to try and do a all-in-one-go save all the survivors run.
Oh, nice.
And I might be able to do it, but it's been a while, so who knows. It can be a challenge. But it's a fun game.
It can be.
Fun game.
Yeah, fun game. Go play Dead Rising. Go watch Moana. Go watch the Bourne trilogy if you want some action.
Listen to old episodes of this podcast.
This is not the worst movie we ever talked about on here. We just talked about North a couple months ago.
North is significantly worse.
Yeah. But, yeah, not good. Thanks for joining me, though, Matt.
No problem.
Yeah, we got stuff coming up.
Yeah.
You know what? No. I will do we have three possible movies left. I'm going to do the little rotating random number generator right now.
All right.
Just plugging away at that. Okay. Ready?
Yes.
Our next movie is Starship Troopers.
Hey!
I'm very happy about that.
That's never a better time to discuss Starship Troopers.
Oh my god. I know. What the fuck is even going to happen? Like,
we'll see. The president might be in trouble. But hey, that might actually be some good news for once.
Yeah, yeah. There might be some good news, hopefully.
Wouldn't that Fingers be wild crossed. If there were actual consequences for actions?
For the rich, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. The rich and powerful.
Yeah.
That'd be nice.
They'll never
Until
do it.
Until then, tune in next time to find out the answer to that question.
Yes.
Here on the Waffle Press Retrospectives Failed Blockbuster Season 2. Matt, thank you again for joining me. Where can the people find you?
I'm at EmperorOTN1 at Twitter.com and follow me on Twitter to see if I start streaming video games.
Yeah.
Which I'm trying to do.
Yeah. Also follow me at the Diego Crespo. Check out the Waffle Press on Twitter, YouTube, SoundCloud, Spotify, iTunes, and Patreon, where you can get early access to the next retrospectives. Maybe, hopefully, the rest of the retrospectives for failed blockbusters by that point.
We'll see.
Who knows? Who knows? Who knows? But thank you, everyone, for listening. Thanks for watching. Like and subscribe. If you didn't like this, like and subscribe anyways, because you might find something to do, like take care of each other, go do a good thing, go donate to some charity or something.
Death to the fascist insect that preys upon the life of the people.
That's the one. All right, we've been professionally unprofessional.
So long, everyone.
I have something set up for me. We need your help.
Soon we will rule all of the world.
So how do we stop him? Try to keep up.
You know what's waiting. Set has an army behind him. Gods. Beasts. Demons.
You will bring them reckoning!
Bow before me or die.
I won't make that mistake.
That's a storm.
Sets hunters riding their pets.
We should run.
Run?
We mortals do it all the time!